great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountains I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross is spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings called me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. That sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise.
Salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my
worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Sing Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show
bye. Who am I that the highest king would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me, and oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me.
Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died.
Good morning, everyone. I hope everyone had a great week. I'm excited for Easter in 2 weeks and celebrating the resurrection of Jesus, raising from the dead. So let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll go ahead and get started. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this beautiful Sunday, God. Lord, I thank you for every youth that is watching this right now. Lord, I just thank you for the ability to just come to you, to learn more about you, to grow in you, and to draw closer to you. Lord, I thank you that we're not so concerned about having a religion as we are having a strong relationship with you. And I just ask that in this time, Lord, that we just be able to draw closer to you, to know you more, and to just become more like you. And I just ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So today we're continuing our series of Lost and Found. All right. So last week, Pastor Caleb talked about how Jesus values us. We learned how that we shouldn't value ourselves or others based on the world standards, but that we should see ourselves and others as God sees us. We should remind ourselves that God thinks that we are worth dying for, and even the people we struggle to love are of great value to him. Because we know, if you watch my English service last week, I talked about John 3:16 and how God so loved the world that he came so that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. But he loved the world, and how God loves all of us equally, to the point that he's willing to bankrupt heaven so that we might be able to know him intimately and to spend eternity with him. So we learned about how Jesus values us and others, and today we're going to be continuing this series of Lost and Found. Let's go ahead and watch this short video now.
Oh, le monsieur me dit, oh, mais là, comme ça.
Last couple of weeks, we've also been talking about losing stuff, losing stuffed animals, getting ourselves lost, and finding weird things in the lost and found. But have you ever thrown something away that you later regretted? Have you thrown out money before by accident? What have you accidentally thrown out? Go ahead and share with us in the chat. As you see in this video, this woman accidentally throws her phone out, which is pretty terrible. But I have some funny stories about things that I've accidentally thrown out by accident, including money. I think I've accidentally thrown my phone in the garbage before. And it's really embarrassing when you do. So I once lost an expensive pair of sunglasses. And this is a story of a time that I accidentally lost something. And this pair of sunglasses was pretty expensive, and I felt really bad because they were actually a gift. And so I went ahead and I called all these businesses that I had went to that day, and I actually went physically to some of them and started looking around to retrace my steps. I remember actually going to the movie theater because I had gone out with my wife to see a movie, and I was searching the rows like later on with the flashlight on my phone, looking under all of the seats, going from row to row. And then I like turned my car upside down, thinking maybe I just left them in the car. But sadly, I was never able to find those glasses. So it was a pretty embarrassing moment of the time I lost something and I just couldn't find it. What about you? We've laughed at a lot of stories we've shared so far, but losing things isn't always funny. Sometimes we lose things that are valuable. Sometimes we lose things that are valuable. Maybe, have you ever felt ashamed of losing something valuable? Honestly, you know, some things we really, really don't want to lose. Like, as a parent, I don't accidentally want to lose my son. But I want you to think about something that you lost that you felt really ashamed of losing. Did you ever lose something that was really sentimental? Did you break something that didn't belong to you? Did you misplace something that you knew was going to get you into trouble? I think I've done all of those things and always had these feelings of shame and fear afterwards. So it's difficult to lose something that really matters to you, but it's even worse when you know it's your fault that it's gone wrong, because you have that feeling like of shame and guilt that, man, if only I was paying more attention, if only I valued that more, I wouldn't have lost it. And this has happened to me more times than I can count. So over the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about things that are lost and how they get found again. Specifically, we've been talking about what we do when we feel a little lost. Sometimes we feel lost because we don't feel noticed or seen. We don't feel valuable. We know that we've messed up and aren't sure how to fix it. Or we feel inadequate or unable to do something. And so it's easy for us to get lost. Have you ever felt such an excruciating insecurity or fear that you were taking a test or maybe talking to someone and you drew a major blank? I've had this happen to me preaching and many other times before. Today, we're going to hear the story of a young man who lost everything because of his mistakes and how we're sometimes a lot like him. But before we hear his story, I want to go ahead and share a story of my own where I was lost and I lost myself and I lost my way from God. So I don't know if you have a story exactly like mine, but I'm guessing you can probably relate. Maybe you did something to create a distance between you and someone you love, or maybe a distance between you and God. So what happened with myself, though, is, and I actually told my testimony when I preached for the English service, the adult service last week. And basically what happened is I felt that I couldn't live up to the standards that I felt that God was imposing upon me to be a Christian. I felt that I couldn't be perfect enough. And I felt that with all this peer pressure and this pressure to be good enough from everybody, that I was just going to be a hypocritical Christian, like all these other Christians that I saw that went to church or said they were Christians and then just did a lot of terrible things that didn't honor God or wasn't in line with the Bible. And so basically, I did my own thing. I pursued my own self-interest. I ignored God and I was prideful. I turned my back on God and I felt alone and depressed. I couldn't see a way back to God. And by definition, I was lost and I didn't have a way back. I didn't see any way to get back to where I belonged, which was in Christ. Do you feel distant from God, either because of your choices or because you've never really been close to God before? Are you like me when I was lost from God? Have you made a mistake that ruined everything and you wish things would go back to how they used to be? Do you feel like something's happened to you, that you did something and you can't take it back and now your life is ruined and there's no way back and you feel lost and helpless? Because one of the things that you feel when you're lost is helpless. So if you're feeling helpless, you're pretty much lost. So throughout the series, we have been talking about the parables where Jesus talked about recovering lost things like lost sheep and a lost coin. And these stories Jesus told about things that were lost, Jesus told these stories to the Pharisees, religious leaders who had become arrogant, self-righteous, dismissive people who they believe, and they were dismissive of people who they believed were sinful, people who they believed were dirty, who were incapable of being saved, people who were below them, and basically they, in a sense, they canceled them. You know, you hear all about this cancel culture, but they were dismissive of people. They just showed them no attention at all. They saw them and then they forgot them. After they saw them, they judged them, and then they forgot them. So first, Jesus told a story about a lost sheep to show the Pharisees God isn't angry or judgmental when we wander away. Instead, God finds us and carries us lovingly back to safety. And we see this photo of Jesus carrying the sheep. We learned about how Jesus will leave the 99 for that one because Jesus values us so much. And then the second story Jesus told was about a woman who lost a coin to show the Pharisees that God doesn't give up on us when we wander away. Instead, God values and keeps looking for us. And so she searched her entire house. She looked everywhere. And then when she found it, she celebrates. And so we learned these really important lessons, how God is constantly seeking after us and how he values us more than we can really comprehend. But also we learn how God values others and how, like the Pharisees, we should not be like the Pharisees and be dismissive of others, but that we should value everyone as Jesus values them. Even the people that we don't think are nice people, that we think are mean or cruel or rude or arrogant or prideful, stupid, you name it. Because I know that we all have people like that or have met people like that where we want to dismiss them and just act as if they don't exist. But we need to remember and learn from what we've learned in the past few lessons that Jesus values them and we need to value them too. So let's see what Jesus is trying to communicate with this third story that we're going to read today. And this third story comes from Luke 15, 11 through 19. So go ahead and read with me. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. the younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of the country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomachs with the pods the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. We read that, and it's hard to imagine that this guy's life could get any worse, that he was in the pits of despair because of his poor choices and because of the choices that he made. So I think we can probably all find some things that we have in common with this son. Okay? So we go ahead and continue reading here in Luke 15:11-19. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and here I am starving to death? I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.'" I think we have to note here that he came to his senses. He realized that he made some really terrible choices. And what we see here is him going through his mind and coming to this conviction that he needs to repent and go back to his father and beg for forgiveness. And not with pride or arrogance, like he left when he asked his father for all his money, but with this humility and with a repentant heart. So, again, I ask, how can we relate to the prodigal son? Even though the son had safety, food, and money at home, he was dreaming of going to the distant land where he imagined he could do whatever he wanted to. Spend his money, have fun, find everything he thought was missing at home. How some of us might imagine college might be when we leave home and we're no longer underneath our parents' authority and we can kind of make our own schedule. Or maybe how I imagine when I left for the military and I had my own way about doing things and thought I'm going to go and forge my own way and do as I wanted. And more importantly, I left the lordship of Jesus Christ and started becoming the God of my own life. So he was impulsive. I was impulsive when I walked away from Christ. He made a big decision, apparently, without getting any guidance or wisdom from others. I definitely was there. How about you? Have you ever done something like this? You didn't ask your parents. You didn't ask your Bible teacher. So he was hurtful. He may not have meant it this way, but his actions and words hurt his dad by asking for his inheritance early. It's like he was saying, "Dad, you're not worth more. You're worth more to me dead than alive. Give me that money that I don't have. Give me that money so that I don't have to depend on you or have a relationship with you anymore." It's like you going to your parents and say, "Give me your car keys, give me your account information, and get out of the house. Or just give it to me, I'm leaving, I'm going to go get my own place. And I don't want nothing else to do with you anymore." So it was also selfish, because by not stopping to reflect on his actions, that his actions might be hurtful to his family, the son was acting selfishly. He cared only about his money and his big adventures, not the people who loved him. Not his father, not his brothers, not anyone else, just about his desire to do what he wanted. For a while, the son lived the kind of life he dreamed about until he couldn't anymore. The famine came, people lost jobs, he struggled to find food, he worked for a pig farmer, he ate whatever the pigs ate, he was in the pits, no way out. So of course, the son in the story never existed. But if he had, I think we can assume he would have been pretty broken at this point. He had thrown away everything that had been good in his life. He had lost his family, his money, his livelihood, and maybe even his faith. He was holding on to nothing but vanity, and that vanity took everything from him. That selfish desire, that pride, that sinful way of living and thinking destroyed his entire life. So remember, Jesus was telling this story not to these sinful people that were sick and terrible and dirty and filthy and did not know God, but to these religious leaders. He was telling it to the Pharisees, these leaders who saw pigs as unclean animals, forbidden by God. In order to follow and be loved by God, they believed you couldn't eat any pork. So this son was disgusting to them because he was eating pig's feet and he was hanging out with the pigs. So when the son in the story ate with the pigs, the Pharisees would have seen this as a sin against God. Just think about it. When we hear this, we think it's kind of disgusting. Imagine what they saw it as. Like, they must immediately condemn this guy, not only for his actions, but also because he's over here eating with the pigs. So while you might feel compassion for the son in this story, the Pharisees would likely have felt disgust. They would have come to a much different conclusion and not felt compassion for him or that he deserved a second chance. Because of his own bad decisions, the son had found himself disconnected from others and from God. He was probably filled with shame for what he had done and fear about what he needed to do next. Desperate, he decided to go home, not as a son, but hoping to become a servant in his father's house. Not as entitled, not as someone who was seeking his own gain, but someone who was repentant and hoping for salvation through his father as a servant with total humility. So let's go ahead and read the rest of the story of his return here. So Luke 15:20-24. So he got up and he went to his father, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, he threw his arms around him, and he kissed him. The son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." So they began to celebrate. What an awesome story. What a response. I mean, can you imagine if you put yourself in his shoes, like, wow, I want a daddy like that, right? Like, that's an awesome dad, right? Can you imagine being welcomed home like this after wasting the money, disgracing his father and his family, and bringing shame on himself and his father and the whole household? But his father is still filled with love and compassion for him. The father runs to his son, hugs and kisses him. And guess what? The hug isn't, and the kiss isn't the only thing he gave his son. But he gave him so much more than that. He gave him a ring to put on his finger, a ring that could resemble that he's part of this family, that you're mine. You know, when we look at giving of rings, you know, like for myself, a wedding ring, it's a really big deal when you give somebody a ring. And then he clothed him. So I don't have a robe here, but I have a jacket. You can imagine that he's in these tattered clothes and he doesn't deserve to be clothed in a beautiful jacket. But much like God says, he clothes us in righteousness. He put a robe on him. And something about that that we read in Bible times, when somebody puts a robe on them, a robe can resemble so many things. When we look at Jacob giving Joseph this robe of many colors, it's an act of love and admiration for this person, because this robe says that you're mine and you're my son. It's a royal robe. When I go in the military, I wear a uniform that says that I'm part of the military to serve and defend, and it shows authority. But a robe in your father's house shows that you're part of that family and that you're underneath him in sonship. But then he also gave him sandals. I didn't bring sandals here, but I brought some shoes just so that we can kind of think about it. So he gives him sandals. Can you imagine how dirty and filthy his feet were and how he probably had tattered shoes? But he gives him sandals and he clothes the dirtiest part of his body. So he has something clean to put on his feet so that his feet don't continue to get filthy and dirty. And this is so that he also doesn't get blisters. And so when he's walking, you know, he can go farther distances. It's like he basically like gave him all the care he needed. And when we read about God gives us, you know, the sandals of peace, you know, we receive sandals and it's a new way. It's essentially a comfort, you know? So he extends every comfort to him that he would to any other person of his household, that and more. And all we have to do is think about Jesus and think about God to see a similar act when we come to Christ and we're redeemed, how God welcomes us into his house, how he gives us the Holy Spirit to live inside of us, and how he favors us and he blesses us and he cares for us and we're underneath his protection, and how Jesus constantly intercedes on our behalf at the right hand of God. You know, when we see the same type of love and the same type of acceptance from Jesus as that we see from this father in this story. So, remember, Jesus told this story to help us discover something important about who God is and what God is calling us to do. We read years later, after Jesus' death and resurrection and ascension into heaven, that Paul wrote in Romans 2 a similar dialogue. So, let's go ahead and read that now. Romans 2, 1 through 4. Therefore, you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges. For in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself. Because you, the judge, practices the very same thing. We know that the judgment of God rightly fals on those who practice such things. Do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who practice such things and yet do them yourselves, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? So we read how if we've truly have come to God, you know, and we've received this grace as prodigal sons, how and it should lead us to love others as he has loved us in the same way. How we should be willing to wash others' feet as Jesus washes our feet. How he takes on the position of a servant to serve others, not to be served. And so by being served by God, we should be convicted, and we should, because of that love as a response to that, the natural response, what Paul is telling us, is to do the same as unto others. So God, Jesus instructs us to love others as we love ourselves. And so if we've experienced this, we shouldn't be judging others as these Pharisees judge them, but we should be seeing them as Jesus sees them, with compassion, with forgiveness, with kindness and love, grace and mercy. Not that we accept their sin or condone their sin, but that we truly desire for them to be saved, that we truly desire for them to be well, and we truly desire for them to have a home and to be found, not to be lost. Because everyone who is apart from God is lost. Even Christians that are not living as God intends for them to live, they're lost in their own way. And so for those Christians that we see doing sinful things, we should want them to come back into the fold and to be living for Christ and to be loving and to serving God. But we don't want to sit there and judge them and condemn them. But instead, what we should do is we should be able to love them as the Father does here, with grace, compassion, and mercy, and with this attitude of serving them as Jesus has served us. So like the Father in Jesus' parable, God is so kind, loving, and patient with us. God isn't angry. He isn't an angry old man waiting to just throw lightning at us when we mess up. But God is like a loving Father that is always ready to accept us home. And Jesus is God. I hope that this story reminds you that when you feel lost, that Jesus welcomes us back. That you'll know with confidence that no matter where you're at, that God's sin is enough. I mean, that God's free gift of salvation and that God's love is enough for you, that he is willing to accept you back and that your sin is not too much for God to handle. That God can forgive you and that he can renew you and make you new like he did, like he tells of the father and the parable son in this parable here, and the prodigal son. Okay, so Jesus welcomes you back. So I told you a time when I was lost earlier a few moments ago, but I did leave out a part that's really, really important that I want to share with you. And that is the part where Jesus welcomed me back. Okay? Jesus showed me that I can come to him as I am and that he wasn't waiting for me, that and that he was waiting for me with open arms, and that he didn't ever give up on me. Even when I was in my sin, like the prodigal son, and I was doing all these things that I shouldn't have been doing, when I turned my back on him, when I said, I really don't even care, you're dead to me, that he came to me and he was waiting for me to return so that he could accept me with open arms. He showed me that I didn't have to be perfect to be his son. Because, see, Jesus is the perfect Son of God who pays the debt for our sins. It's Jesus that frees us from ourselves. And it's Jesus' free gift to all of us, not just me, but to everyone. And if we're to freely accept this gift, we should freely give it to others also. We should freely share Jesus. You see, sharing Jesus with others and showing others the way to salvation, like sharing the gospel and telling them that Jesus died for their sins, isn't just about telling them a Bible story. It's not just about saying, hey, just read John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, so that whoever believes in him shouldn't perish but have eternal life. No, it's more than that. You see, Jesus calls us to be ambassadors. He calls us to do as he did and to love them and to model Christ-like behavior for them, to serve others. Because when we serve others, we're serving God. Jesus says, if you love me, you'll feed my sheep. And if you love me, you'll obey my commands. So if we love God, if we know we're loved by God, the natural response is to love God and love others. You can't love God and not love others. And if you feel like you're struggling to love others, as I have many times, just ask God to show you more of his love. Because the more he'll show you of your love, the more he'll show you of his love, the more you're going to be humbled, the more you're going to be blown away by it, the more you're going to feel fulfilled, the more you're going to understand your value and your worth, and it's going to be easier to love others because out of that outflow of Christ's love, we're able to love others because we love because he first loved us. You see, loving others shouldn't be something that you just do out of like, oh, I have to because I got to be a good person. No, you should truly love them in your heart. And sometimes it's hard to love people. I've actually asked God, Lord, help me love them as you love them. Help me see them as you see them and have compassion upon them. Help me to see their pain and their hurt. Help me to understand what they must be going through so that I can have compassion and empathy and so that I can show grace and love as God showed me. So I can remember that when I was in my filth, eating the pig feed, when I was that shameful, prideful, rebellious son and turned my back on God and was a terrible person, that God called me back to him and robed me and clothed me and brought me into his family when I didn't deserve it. So in the same way, I need to do the same to them. So I wonder if any of you need to be welcomed back by God. if maybe you have a relationship with God, but you're not on speaking terms, or you feel like you've done something, you can't talk to God, or you feel like he's mad at you and you don't want to talk to him. Or perhaps maybe you're that person who needs to forgive someone else in your life and welcome them into your life and your personal circle as Jesus welcomes you. I don't know who you are or what you might be going through, but you do know. And you know what God's placing on your heart. And so I want you to just think for a moment now. Ask God to lead your heart. Ask him to show you who is it that you need to love, that you're harboring resentment or unforgiveness for, that you're still feeling hurt about something that someone did towards you, and so because you're feeling that hurt, you're having a hard time forgiving them. And so I want you to think about this. And if you're that son that needs to just come back to God and to find peace in him and know that you're free, all we have to do is just ask him now. So whichever person you are, I want you to pray with me now and let's ask God to bring us back into that fold, into his flock, and to be a welcoming shepherd or servant to those that maybe we have distanced. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I just thank you for the amazing hearts of all of our youth, God. They have intellect like I can't even believe, Lord. They are just so talented and gifted in so many ways, God. But Lord, the thing that astounds me the most is that their heart for you, Lord, and that so many of them continue to come faithfully every week, and they just want to learn and grow in you, Father God, and be more like you. And I've just seen amazing growth, Lord. But Lord, I'm reminded that as myself, I've seen struggle in my life and at times felt lost and distant from you, that some of them might feel that now. And so God, collectively, we come together, Lord, and we just ask for you to accept us back, Lord. We're sorry for all that we've done, Lord. We accept your free gift of forgiveness, Lord, and we just ask you to be God of our lives, Lord. Help us to know that we're safe with you and that we can find comfort, strength, and hope in you, and that, Lord, we don't have to do anything, God, but that your free gift of salvation is here, freely available. All we got to do is come underneath you, Father God, as our King and our God and our Father. And Lord, I just pray now for all of our hearts, Lord. If any of us are holding unforgiveness, resentments, an unwillingness to accept someone, if we've canceled someone or basically dismissed somebody for, you know, sinful acts or things that we're judging them for, Lord, please, Lord, I just ask that you just please help us love them with all sincerity and, Lord, to want to be a servant to them, to show them you in everything that we do, God. That we won't just want to share your word with them, God, but Lord, that we will want to show them you and how we act, Lord, that we will love them because you love us so much, Lord, and we're not worthy, God, and that because you love them, Lord, and they are of great value to you. Lord, we just thank you that you are so wonderful, that you are the most beautiful thing in the whole world, God, and that you are a daddy, that you are a lover, you are our Savior and our caregiver. And Lord, we just thank you that we can rest in you now. And Lord, I just ask that you just go with each of us now. Help us to draw closer to you, just become more like you and look like you in all that we do, Lord. And we just pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, have a great week.
To you, oh Lord, I lift my soul. My trust.